Good morning. Thanks for tuning in to 1140 KSOO. This is Radio Good News. This program has the goal of drawing all people to the love of Jesus Christ. I want everyone to know and experience the fruit of the Holy Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those are key to a Holy Spirit-filled and successful Christian life. I will focus on God's love because you should never underestimate the redemptive power of God's love. I'm John Thornton. I'll be reading from the Bible, the New Revised Standard Version, because that's God's word to us in our language. You can write to me at Radio Good News, P.O. Box 1722, Sioux Falls, South Dakota, 57101. Let's begin today with Psalm 118, verses 1 through 14. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his steadfast love endures forever. Out of my distress I called on the Lord. The Lord answered me and set me in a broad place. With the Lord on my side I do not fear. What can mortals do to me? The Lord is on my side to help me. I shall look in triumph on those who hate me. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to put confidence in mortals. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to put confidence in princes. All nations surrounded me. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me on every side. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me like bees. They blazed like a fire of thorns. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. I was pushed hard so that I was falling. But the Lord helped me. The Lord is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. That's Psalm 118, verses 1 through 14. Our musical guest today is Lounge Freak, featuring John Jones, this with apologies to Jars of Clay.
Stopped raining for days. My world is a flood. Slowly I become one with the mud. But if I can't swim after 40 days and my mind is crushed by the thrashing waves, lift me up so high that I cannot fall, lift me up.
Lift me up
when I'm falling. I'm weak and I'm dying.
Lift me up.
I need you to hold me.
Lift me up.
Keep me from drowning again. Downpour on my soul. Splashing in the ocean. I'm losing control. Dark sky all around. I can't feel my feet touching the ground. But if I can't swim after 40 days and my mind is crushed by the thrashing waves, lift me up so high that I cannot fall. Lift me up.
Lift me up
when I'm falling.
Lift me up.
I'm weak and I'm dying.
Lift me up.
I need you to hold me. I'm drowning again. Calm the storms that drench my eyes. Dry the streams still flowing. Cast down all the waves of sin and the guilt that overthrows me. But if I can't swim after 40 days and my mind is crushed by the thrashing waves, lift me up so high that I cannot fall, lift me up.
Lift me up
when I'm falling.
Lift me up.
I'm weak and I'm dying.
Lift me up.
I need you to hold me. Keep me from drowning again and again. When I'm falling, I'm weak and I'm dying. I need you to hold me. Keep me from drowning again and again. Come on, lift me up.
That's been Lounge Freak featuring John Jonepiss. We'll hear from him again at the end of the program. Turn with me, if you can, to 1 Peter chapter 4. Since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same intention. For whoever has suffered in the flesh has finished with sin, so as to live for the rest of your earthly life, no longer by human desires, but by the will of God. You have already spent enough time in doing what the Gentiles like to do, living in licentiousness, passions, drunkenness, revels, carousing, and lawless idolatry. They are surprised that you no longer join them in the same excesses of dissipation, and so they blaspheme. But they will have to give an accounting to him who stands ready to judge the living and the dead. For this is the reason the gospel was proclaimed even to the dead, so that though they had been judged in the flesh as everyone is judged, they might live in the spirit as God does. The end of all things is near. Therefore, be serious and discipline yourselves for the sake of your prayers. Above all, maintain constant love for one another, for love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaining. Like good stewards of the manifold grace of God, serve one another with whatever gift each of you has received. Whoever speaks must do so as one speaking the very words of God. Whoever serves must do so with the strength that God supplies, so that God may be glorified in all things through Jesus Christ. To him belong the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's sufferings, so that you may also be glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, a criminal, or even as a mischief maker. Yet, if any of you suffers as a Christian, do not consider it a disgrace, but glorify God because you bear this name. For the time has come for judgment to begin with the household of God. If it begins with us, what will be the end for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinners? Therefore, let those suffering in accordance with God's will entrust themselves to a faithful Creator while continuing to do good. Those are God's words from 1 Peter chapter 4. There's an old legend of two homeless men meeting at the bank of a river. The two men met by the bank of the water while one man was very hungry, and he was busy digging about seeking after fishing worms. For a few moments, the hungry digger viewed the other man in stupid wonder and then inquired, "Where are you going?" "I'm going to heaven," replied the man, revealing he was a Christian. "And where is heaven?" asked the hungry digger. "Heaven," said the Christian as he sat down on the bank of the river, "is the best place of love. It is being with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for all eternity. It has wondrous streets of gold, gates and walls made of precious stones, and a beautiful river. In fact, it is the river of life and is pure as crystal. The trees on the bank of that great river have leaves for the healing of the nations." The hungry digger seemed rather unimpressed and continued digging for fishing worms. The Christian just sat on the side of the river. Finally, the hungry man asked him, "Are there any fishing worms in heaven?" "Fishing worms? Well, of course not," said the Christian to the hungry digger. "Well, I guess then that heaven is not too much good to me, because I want some fishing worms so I can catch my supper. Often, people will be so preoccupied with their urgent needs that they'll forget about the truly important needs. In 1 Peter chapter 4, God tells us through the Apostle Peter that we need to be genuine Christians, Christians who are known to the world as real Christians, rather than just a person who's after the next worm, or a person who offers some empty pie in the sky, by and by wistful longing for heaven. Recently, I was reading former President Jimmy Carter's excellent book, Sources of Faith. In President Carter's book, he recalls how some 40 years ago he heard a sermon where the pastor asked, "If you were arrested for being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you?" What a profound thought. So let's look today at 1 Peter chapter 4 for what would be compelling evidence of being a genuine Christian. I believe that Peter is trying to tell us how to make sure that we are really living as followers of Jesus Christ. God wants us to be living lives that demonstrate faith in deeds as well as by words. Peter says in verse 2 that we must live our earthly lives no longer by human desires, but by the will of God. We must not chase after worms and worries of the world. Rather, let us set our hearts on living as followers of loving Jesus Christ. So as we look for evidence of Christianity, I believe we could get a conviction if we found three solid proofs. Peter tells us that true Christians will demonstrate three things. First, we will confess our sins and reject living in sin. Second, we will be obedient to Christ and showing love to all the other people of the world. And third, we will be righteous and endure even in the midst of terrible suffering and evil. If a person lives a life which demonstrates all three of these areas, then the evidence would rule for a conviction on that person being a Christian. By rejecting sin, we Christians will be truly obedient to Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul echoes Peter's teachings here by telling us in Romans 6, verse 5, "For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be destroyed and we might no longer be enslaved to sin." Peter tells us that we have already spent enough time doing bad things. Then he gives us a brief sin list. Have you ever noticed how much God likes lists? Throughout the Bible, God gives us lists of things to avoid. And Peter tells us to avoid living in licentiousness, passions, drunkenness, revels, carousing, and lawless idolatry. Those are things we should avoid. In a Sunday school class, little Amy was busy listening to her teacher. Her teacher explained that God is loving and how Jesus Christ is so compassionate that he will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all our unrighteousness when we confess our sins. The teacher then asked her class, "So class, what must we do before we can be forgiven for our sins?" Little Amy responded and thought, "Well, teacher, it seems to me that first we gotta sin." Yes, we all will sin. There's really not any chance of us not sinning, is there? I know that I am a sinner. I sin in my thoughts, my words, and my deeds. We all are sinners. But Jesus is indeed compassionate and faithful so as to forgive our sins when we confess. We know that some might claim that they're not sinners. There are always those who are quick to point out other people's sins, but never look at their own. And those type of people are some of the most lost. It's really simple to scream about others' sins while ignoring your own. Our Master Jesus said in Matthew 7, verse 3, "Why do you see the speck in your neighbor's eye, but do not notice the log in your own eye?" And the Apostle John tells us in 1 John 1:10, "If we say we've not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us." So indeed, knowing our sins and confessing them and asking for God's forgiveness shows us to be a true Christian. So exhibit one, in the case of proving a Christian is a real Christian, is the evidence that the Christian confesses and rejects the sin that he or she commits. Do you confess and reject your sins? In verse 7, Peter says that the end of all things is near. Yes, even 1,940 some years ago, Peter realized that we're living in the last days. It's nothing new. And Peter tells us to discipline ourselves. Self-discipline's a fruit of the Holy Spirit. And Peter says that to be self-disciplined will show and maintain constant love for one another. That's key. For love covers a multitude of sins. This same teaching is found in the Old Testament. In Proverbs 10, 11 through 12, we read, "The mouth of the righteous is a fountain of life, but the mouth of the wicked conceals violence. Hatred stirs up strife, but love covers all offenses." Love is a universally strong attraction. Even in the animal world, we see how love can work. A great minister of the 19th century was Dr. William Arnott. Once he told his congregation about love. He said that when he was on his father's farm as a child, he often watched his dad teach young calves to drink milk. His father would dip his finger into the milk pail and then put it into the calf's mouth. Gently and slowly, he would repeat this several times, and soon the calf would be drinking all by itself. Dr. Arnott related how similar this is to helping people know about Christianity and about Jesus' love. He said, "If you want to win people to Christ, you must go lovingly to them and lead them gradually to Him. If you do not show love for others, you need not even talk to them, for to show them Jesus is to show them love." Peter says that we must be hospitable toward each other. We must serve each other with whatever spiritual gifts God has empowered us to use. Peter discusses two spiritual gifts, speaking and serving. But the Bible says there are many spiritual gifts, each to be used for the building up of the body of believers and making the world a better place. And as we saw in Proverbs, violence is a terrible sin that robs the body of Christ and disrupts the use of spiritual gifts. Peter learned about how violence is not the mark of being a child of God, or especially of being a follower of Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace. When Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane and the armed detachment came to arrest him, Peter responded in a worldly manner. Peter drew out his sword to defend Jesus Christ. Peter attempted to start a war that he thought was somehow justified. After all, he was trying to defend the innocent Jesus Christ. So Peter whips out his weapon of destruction and chops down hard on Malchus, the servant of the corrupt high priest. Peter struck the man so violently that his ear was severed from his head. It may have nearly decapitated the poor man, so violent was Peter's sin. Then Jesus commanded, "No more of this." And he told his followers, the Christians, to forever put away your swords, for all who would take the sword will perish by the sword. Oh, indeed, how we need to follow that command. And our world needs to put away all our weapons and be real followers of Jesus Christ. Then Jesus showed an example of incredible love. Jesus, in loving kindness, reached out to this man who had come to arrest him. Jesus touched the wounded Malchus and healed his head by miraculously reattaching the man's ear. Peter saw Jesus perform this miracle. And Jesus demonstrated in his actions what he'd been teaching. Jesus showed love even for his enemies and did good to those who were abusing him. Yes, indeed, our Savior Jesus Christ wants people to demonstrate loving compassion in everything that we do. So exhibit two, in the case of proving a Christian is a real Christian, is the evidence that the Christian demonstrates love to all other people. Love must be shown in good deeds toward our fellow Christians, family members, all our neighbors, and even toward our enemies. For a true Christian will know that love covers a multitude of sins. Do you show love and compassion to everyone as Jesus wants you to? Peter tells us that suffering will happen. In verse 12, Peter writes of the fiery ordeal that his readers have been going through. Peter's referring to real flames and real fiery persecution. Peter wrote this letter about the year 60 AD. At that time, Nero was emperor and was rather evil and terrible in what he did to Christians. While the Roman Empire's dominion-wide persecutions would be far worse later under other emperors, Nero certainly was no slouch in his ability to be cruel and evil. The ancient historian Tacitus tells us what Nero did to the Christians. He says, The Christians were killed by methods of mockery. They were torn apart by dogs. They were crucified. And they were set ablaze to light Nero's gardens by night. Nero is also rumored to have burned down his own city of Rome. He may have set it on fire and burned down the city so that he could rebuild it as he desired. And historically, we know that Christians were blamed for that fire. So here, Peter is saying to the Christians not to be surprised by the fiery ordeal that they are enduring. Peter writes, "But rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's sufferings, so that you may also be glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you." See, I believe Peter's remembering what happened to Jesus Christ. If it can happen to the Master, it can certainly happen to the followers. Jesus died on the cross. After Jesus was arrested, he was severely beaten, whipped, cursed, and abused in all manner of vile ways. Jesus was then forced to carry the heavy cross through the streets. He fell exhausted under that weight of the cross, and an African man, Simon of Cyrene, carried the cross the rest of the way. Then Jesus was nailed hand and foot to the cross and tortured to death. And even there, in the middle of suffering, far beyond anything we can imagine, Jesus demonstrated love. Jesus looked at his abusers and said, "Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing." God wants Christians to act as did Jesus. Peter tells us about this in 1 Peter 3, verse 9. Peter says, "Do not repay evil for evil or abuse for abuse, but on the contrary, repay with a blessing. It is for this that you were called, that you might inherit a blessing." And again, we see Peter referring back to the book of Proverbs. In Proverbs 17, verse 13, we read, "Evil will not depart from the house of one who returns evil for good." And in Proverbs 20, verse 22, we read, "Do not say, 'I will repay evil.' Wait for the Lord, and he will help you." God also inspired the Apostle Paul to teach these same Christian values. Paul writes in Romans 12, verse 14, "Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them." And Paul says in Romans 12, 17, "Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all." And God tells us never to be violent when he tells us in Romans 12, 19 through 21, "Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay,' says the Lord." No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink. For by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. So we see that even when terrible suffering happens, a true Christian will not engage in evil deeds. There's never a justification for evil acts. Peter tells Christians to expect some suffering, but that a Christian must never meet evil by evil or respond with violence. Peter says, "If any of you suffers as a Christian, do not consider it a disgrace, but glorify God because you bear this name." And Peter lived this out in his own very life. Tradition tells us that Peter was arrested and executed for his faith. Peter was crucified upside down because he was a Christian, and that happened in about the year 66. Peter does warn us that not all suffering is a result of evil persecution. Peter warns Christians and tells us to be honorable people of integrity and reject our sins. Peter writes in verse 15, "Let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, a criminal, or even as a mischief maker." We need to be good, honorable people. Far too many Christians have embraced evil deeds and then put some religious-sounding lip service on it. But sin is still sin. And then when those evil deeds are confronted, those people, they might say it's unjust suffering. But that's wrong, for evil deeds will result in negative consequences. So exhibit 3, in our case of proving a Christian is a real Christian, does the Christian endure suffering without resorting to evil practices? Do you endure suffering without inflicting evil on others? That is the mark of a true Christian. So let's come back to the question that has been so important for former President Jimmy Carter. if you were arrested for being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? I believe that Jimmy Carter has demonstrated time and time again that he's a real Christian. Do you demonstrate to the world that you are a real Christian by your deeds? For a real Christian who lived out the kind of life God commands us to, we have lots of examples. One is St. Francis of Assisi. A prayer that he wrote has been translated into modern English. His prayer demonstrates that the life of a real Christian is one that rejects sins. The life of a real Christian is one that demonstrates love for all human beings. And the life of a real Christian is one that endures hardship and suffering, as certainly did St. Francis. St. Francis had a hard life, and yet he was devoted to Jesus Christ and lovingly served the needs of other people. He's a fine example that we should follow. The prayer of St. Francis. Lord Jesus Christ, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me so love. Where there is injury, let me so pardon. Where there is despair, let me so faith. Where there is darkness, let me so light. And where there is sadness, let me so joy. For it is in the giving that we receive, it is in the pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in the dying that we are born to eternal life. So, in the meeting of our two friends at the riverside, what should have happened? Well, the Christian man should have gotten down and helped the other man to get what he needed, even if it meant digging in the mud for worms. By doing this, the man would have been providing for the other's physical needs. Then that man would have been demonstrating true Christianity. For indeed, actions speak far louder than mere words. And the hungry man would have been open and receptive to hearing about heaven and may have turned to the good news about how loving Jesus Christ in faith is the only way of salvation. Then they could have shared a wonderful meal of fish. I'll leave you today with the question, that nagging question. If you were arrested for being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? Real Christians believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. I believe that he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, in the worldwide Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. I'm John Thornton. Thanks very much for listening to Radio Good News. I encourage you to seek out a church family where you can worship, be encouraged, and surround yourself with genuine Christians. For this area offers many fine Bible-believing and teaching churches of a wide variety of denominations. May you richly know the blessings of the God who was, the God who is, and the God who is to come again. And always remember, love the Lord our God with all your heart, strength, soul, and mind, and love your neighbors as yourselves. Jesus said that's the great commandment. We'll finish today's program with John Jonathis with apologies to Audio Adrenaline.
I could move to Hollywood, get my teeth capped, yeah, I know I could, be a big star on the silver screen, just like James Dean. I could be a star. I could climb the corporate ladder by selling Liquidate. Maybe be just like Sinatra, a melodic singing heavyweight. I could learn to sing and dance if I only had a chance. I could be a star. I could be anything I wanted to. I could be anything, but one thing's true. Never gonna be as big as Jesus. Never gonna hold the world in my hands. Never gonna be as big as Jesus. Never gonna build promised land, but